Here we are, Wolf Gulch. My name is Maud Powell, and we're here on our farm, Wolf Gulch Farm. We're in the Little Applegate Valley. And my husband and I have been farming here for about 17 years with our kids, who are 17 and 13. And I also work at Oregon State University at the Small Farms Program. So I run that program in Jackson and Josephine counties. And then my husband and I coordinate the Siskiyou Sustainable Cooperative, which is an agricultural cooperative of 7 farms in the Applegate and Williams Valleys. And it's primarily a marketing and distribution cooperative. In addition, there's some equipment sharing and bulk buying that we do as well. But it's primarily, we run a community-supported agriculture program. We had 275 members this year, so community boxes that we were distributing from Grants Pass down to Ashland and lots of the towns between then. So we coordinate that CSA program. And so the other members of the Siskiyou Sustainable Cooperative are Seven Seeds Farm, Dancing Bear Farm, Sun Spirit Farm, Wandering Fields, Barking Moon Farm, L&R Family Farm, and I always feel bad about the one I missed. Maybe that's it. Let me just think. Barking Moon. Well, Wolf Gulch, so our farm. Yeah, so that's the 7 farms. So our first season on the farm was 1999. But that year was mostly building infrastructure. So I think we started at markets in 2000. Yeah, so it was fairly early on in the life of our farm, but it didn't necessarily feel like a risk. Like I said, I mean, the bar was kind of low. I mean, we did inherit some debt, although we were coordinating it, so it wasn't as if we personally inherited it. It was the co-op's debt, and we were sort of mandated to get rid of the debt in a few years and pay off the farmers. Because the co-op at this point is really just about organizing the CSA, we meet throughout the winter. The CSA program runs, we deliver boxes from early June through November, so basically until Thanksgiving. So the winter months are freed up for us to do crop planning and marketing. So essentially the growers meet, we meet about every other week in the winter. I just wanna add that the meetings are really fun. There's often beer drinking involved, but it's always a laugh. And I think that's part of what makes our co-op great and functional, is that we enjoy each other's company and meetings are not a burden, they're actually really enjoyable. So we meet through the winter months and we essentially decide on who's gonna grow what during the season. So we have, you know, pretty complex spreadsheets at this point, divvying up the farm, depending on what the crop is, into 4 or 5 or 6 compartments, whether that's months or parts of the season. And so farmers essentially get to decide what they wanna grow, what's gonna work into their individual production plans on their farms. It might have to do with the cash flow for them. If they need money in the early spring, they might focus more on spring crops, etc. So, you know, it's kind of a bidding system. We do, if a farmer has successfully grown a crop the past season, then they kind of get first dibs at growing that crop again. In some cases, there's some negotiating that happens because some crops are more profitable than others. Some are less appealing, for example, things that you have to harvest a lot of peas and beans can be hard to get people to grow. So sometimes we all share the burden and take on growing some of those. But we've been doing it for, Tom and I have been coordinating the co-op for 12, this is our 12th season. So we're pretty seasoned at it. We've kind of gone through a lot of bumps in the road. The co-op, we've dealt with, you know, pretty serious issues. Probably the biggest one we've faced is quality control. So figuring out what are our standards and how do we make sure that at packout, when we're packing out the boxes and something is of inferior quality, how we flag that, how we process that as a co-op. So there's been negotiating through the years, but we have, I think, done a really good job of figuring out systems that work.
It looks like we've got some nice green lettuce, we've got kale, parsley, broccoli, so lots of nice good fall greens. And then down underneath here, we've got some winter squash, it looks like. Let's see. Sun gold cherry tomatoes, sweet peppers, so still some good summer stuff. Eggplants, summer squash, onions, and last but not least, I'm gonna guess potatoes, let's see. Oh, nice, purple Viking, beautiful potatoes.
What's your favorite part of the pack out?
Oh, all the good company. Donuts. I am putting lids on the boxes so they can be loaded in the truck and delivered to the several, like 10 drop points from Grants Pass, Medford, Central Point, Ashland.
One day.
How long have you been doing this?
I am one of the two remaining original members since 04. Yeah, three. When did we start? 03?
I don't know. Yeah, they're right around there. That sounds right.
Yeah. You're Dancing Bear.
I am.
Nice. Wanted to meet you.
Yeah, there's two of the original crew left. I do it in a much smaller capacity than a lot of these guys. I have markets and a lot of seed crops I do as well.
Why have you stuck with it, Steve?
It's fun. And you get comments from customers, mostly good, like, oh, that lettuce was amazing. And I know that week I had all the lettuce. So I feel good. And it's farming. You grow food, you sell it, you deliver it, and this is good food.
Our CSA boxes, our drop points are either a local business or they are someone's house. And so, like in Ashland, we have four drop points. We've done a lot in the CSA with doing partnerships with businesses and corporations. So we work with Asante and All Care and Oregon Shakespeare Festival, and we actually deliver to their places of work. But mostly it's in towns, but in a couple cases, they're more urban drop points. Okay. I mean, rural drop points, sorry. Not at all. Hi, wanna be on camera? He's really camera shy. So it started, the co-op started in 2002, and there was kind of a loose affiliation of farmers in the Applegate Valley. They were called the Applegate Agrarians, and they ran a harvest fair in the fall together, and they kind of did some informal, you know, buying of quantity inputs and marketing, sharing booths at farmers markets and such. But it was, like I said, it was fairly informal. And then in 2002, a man moved to Williams who had experience with business and financing. So he had worked for Dell and Kodak, and he wanted to get into the sustainable lifestyle, but he brought this whole skill set with him. And he really saw a huge advantage to this group of farmers getting more serious, writing a business plan, getting incorporated with the state. So he was able to secure funding from Oregon Department of Agriculture to write a business plan and to have this group of farmers incorporate. It was a guy called Rob Hambleton. Now, I was pregnant at the time, so I was not attending these meetings. Tom went to some of them. And But what I hear is that they were really difficult. There were a lot of farmers that started off in the co-op. Then there was attrition as disagreements came up. The business plan that was written is, I have a copy somewhere, and it's really visionary and far-reaching, and it has a lot of great components, things like shared healthcare for farmers, a large processing facility that was going to be built in Williams for seed processing, a value-added kitchen, commercial kitchen. And this is my interpretation, but there were ways that there was not enough planning that was done. So for example, there was a farm stand built on Highway 238, and the farm stand quickly went into debt because there really wasn't enough analysis about traffic patterns and staffing and how to differentiate products between the growers. So we were really not very involved the first couple of years because Tom had an off-farm job. I was taking care of the kids. We were just had a fairly small operation here. But the co-op at that point did go into debt. So then Tom and I took over in 2005 was the first year we ran the CSA. And so we inherited some debt, not a huge amount, but some debt in the co-op that we were able to pay off within a couple of years. And so at that point, when we took over, it was kind of a skeleton crew. There were only a few farmers that were still interested in trying this cooperative venture. So in a way, it was good. The bar was set really low for us. I think at that point, there were maybe five farmers that were involved. And so we just kind of have gradually built it up over the years. We have had the same farmers in the co-op since 2007. So we lost one farmer because he moved. But aside from that, we have not lost any farmers from 2007. We've also not added any because we're really kind of at a sweet spot. This seven farms is just about right in terms of what our capacity is for CSA members, in terms of just the logistics of coordinating farmers. We have certainly talked about growing, but we're also cognizant of growing pains that could make the co-op a lot less fun to be a part of, possibly less profitable, more complicated. So we're pretty happy with how things are. We do offer some special items. So we offer, in terms of adding new growers to the cooperative or producers, we do buy in bread from Rise Up Bakery, and we buy Chev and Feta from Mama Terra, the micro creamery out in Williams. We do bring in honey and eggs from other producers. And then additionally, there are times of the year where we do buy in berries from Pennington Farm because our producers don't have necessarily berries early in the season. So there's a couple parts to it in terms of adding new members. One is that the growers don't necessarily want to share in what they're able to produce for the co-op. So they don't necessarily want to add a new grower and then have a smaller piece of the pie. The other issue really has to do with like personalities and group dynamics. And, you know, over the years I've been asked to speak on panels. I've consulted with other groups. I've had a lot of opportunities where someone will come to me and say, hey, you know, I really want to start a co-op like yours. And I'm always happy to share whatever I can with them and, you know, our experience and the challenges we faced and why I think our co-op works. But ultimately, I think it is really challenging to have a group of producers that works as well as we do together. And like I said, that really enjoys each other. And I think that we're really committed to each other's farms. So there's some great examples of just where people have stepped up to help each other in times of need, or just, you know, really like, I talk a lot about like social capital and building social capital. And I think there's so much of that in our co-op because we know each other's families. You know, over the years, our kids have grown up at Packout. Like I said, we share equipment. We exchange, so much information is exchanged during Packout. Sometimes I just want to record Packout because people will talk about, you know, what varieties of lettuce are doing well or what pest issues they're dealing with or, you know, impacts of... Oh, sorry. Yeah. So Packout happens every Thursday morning, and it's the point where we're actually building the CSA boxes. So the farmers all get together. We actually meet at L&R Family Farm because they're the most centrally located, And so we lay out all the boxes, everyone brings their produce, and then we distribute the produce amongst the boxes, pack the boxes into the two distribution vehicles. And the whole process takes about an hour and a half. And it's like, people come to pack out, you know, we'll have interns come or occasionally a guest will come. And it's like one of these sort of peak experiences of, it's almost like, to me, it's like being in a hive. Like you're a worker bee in a hive, and you have this, you know, it's well orchestrated. Tom is very organized, so he kind of runs the show. And so it's this like satisfying feeling of getting a ton of work done. Like you think we're packing 275 boxes of food for people, and it just kind of happens, and you're like working with all these other people, and it's sort of this like really intricate dance, and it's highly efficient, which I think is satisfying for people just to be part of a system that works. And like I said, all this information is exchanged. It's fun. We started playing music at Packout this year, or, you know, playing, someone puts it, brings a stereo in their car and plays music. So it's really like celebratory. And, you know, a lot of farmers, like you said, a lot of farmers do go to market. So they kind of get that experience of being, you know, being with other farmers and being part of a system with a lot of moving parts that's satisfying. And in the case of market, you know, you're able to interact with your customers and get instant feedback on your produce, which we don't get with the CSA. But I do think it's great. And then unlike farmers market, at 9:15, the farmer drives away and has the rest of the day to work on their farm and do whatever they need to do, and they're not stuck at market until 2 or 3 p.m. and then having to schlep everything home.
Okay, so Stevens, and this is the Asante. This gets hot peppers.
Yes,
got it. Okay, next.
I stacked some over here.
Okay. I don't know if they're fast.
Okay, we got them.
Tarzan gets hot peppers.
I missed it. I was like, where are? I was just talking to Tom. It seems like we don't have enough boxes.
Sen.
We got them.
Sweet. One.
I just missed it.
Okay. Yeah. 42 total.
And yeah.
Sorry.
Close enough.
This is not
time. 42 or so.
And then Corno.
Where you put the?
I mean, I think part of what's nice at Packout too is just being with, just being with people that are living the same reality you are. I mean, I think farming is, you know, it's coming back, but I think it's still, it's unusual to be a farmer, and we do live in a rural community, so there are people working on the land, but, you know, most people are in front of a computer most of the day or inside, and so having people that are, you know, similar values and that are doing what you're doing most days is, I think it's great.
What have been some of the biggest challenges that you've seen in kind of growing and maintaining the co-op?
Yeah, so the biggest issues I would say that we've dealt with in the co-op are quality control, and I think some of that was a little bit of a philosophical difference within the co-op. So there were certain people in the co-op who felt like, we need to educate people about eating seconds. So you can't always expect everything to be cosmetically perfect, and that whole value system is something we need to get rid of. And people need to learn that, you know, if you've got a few holes in your carrots, it's not a big deal. Other people in the co-op actually felt like, hey, we're marketing organic produce here. This is really about having a successful business. We need to have high quality. We're competing with grocery stores. And ultimately that camp kind of won out. So what we did as a group is we sat down. Again, there was beer involved, which made it fun. And we went through every item that we offer, so every vegetable and fruit, and we actually created benchmarks. So whether it was, some of it was size, because farmers would show up to pack out with different sized bunches of beets. And so we had to make some sort of standards. So whether it was, you know, the beets need to be the size of a golf ball or larger, or you're only allowed to have two blemishes on an apple and neither of them can be like a real hole. So that type of thing. I don't think we allow two holes in apples, by the way. So we went through every single crop and came up with standards. And then we came up with a protocol. So there's one thing to have the standards, but then are people meeting them? So we came up with a simple outline for when you're putting, and one rule we have is that you do not distribute your own produce. Your produce has to be distributed by another farmer because we want more sets of eyes on it. So if you're distributing someone's produce and you see that it doesn't meet quality standards, it's not personal. We try to make a culture of it's fine to flag something. It doesn't mean that you're narking on your you know, neighbor farmer. So you would say, hey guys, I'm seeing an issue. The farmers all gather around. We take a vote. We look at some of the produce. And then at that point, the farmer who brought the produce can either choose to go through and glean it on the spot and then adjust their invoice to take away the produce that was not acceptable. They can just decide not to put any in, again, adjust their invoice. And I guess those would be the main options. So so it's worked pretty well. For me, I always harp on it because I interface with the customers, so I'm the one that gets complaints. We do have a policy of anytime someone complains, we always replace that item the next week, no questions asked. I encourage people to complain. I'd rather people complain and get the product, get something they want than to not be happy and then not sign up the next year or tell their friends, you know, the quality isn't good enough. And plus I want that feedback so I can pass it on to the other farmers. So that's kind of been how we've, because I think in any cooperative situation, quality always comes up because you've got multiple growers who have different eyes and different internal standards about what they think is okay. You know, you can be in the middle of August and you might have an aphid infestation and you kind of want to get away with moving this product, and it's not going to sell at market when customers can pick it up. So on some level you might subconsciously kind of want to move it through the co-op and hope that no one notices, and that's understandable. You know, we're all in this together. So we do try to make it a culture where it's okay to flag stuff. We appreciate it. You know, farmers might get defensive, but it's all for the greater good. It's all for us having high standards and have members that come back. So that's one issue. I'd say the other big issue, and this is kind of for me personally, has been in marketing. So with CSAs, what I have noticed myself, and I think it's been pretty well documented, is that CSAs were initially really about supporting the farmer. So it was really about, let's support agriculture, local agriculture. It was often like a group of citizens or group of eaters would get together and they'd hire a farmer to grow their food. So it was really about like supporting that farmer. It was, you know, early on, there was so much emphasis on we're buying a share into the farm. We take risks. If there's a crop failure, that's okay because the farmer's lost, we lose, we're shareholders. That was the attitude. And then what I've seen, and I think it's a result of the fact that local food is so much more accessible. So there's lots of farmers markets, there's local food offered in grocery stores, there's more farm stands, there's just lots of ways to access food. Their online platforms. So now it's really much more about pleasing the customers and being customer based. So over the years, we've made all kinds of changes. So just a couple examples. At one point, probably 5 or 6 years ago, we were getting a lot of feedback from people. Well, I'm not going to sign up next year because it's too much food. I'm just one person, or we're a couple, we travel a lot, we can't eat this much food. So from there, we decided to start, we added a mini share. So we always had a large and a small, and then we added a mini, which is really designed for one person. And that's great for the consumer because they can invest less money, get portions that are commensurate with how much they eat. For us, it's a lot more work because now we have three box sizes that we have to manage. Another example is vacations. So we now allow people to go put their box on hold if they're out of town, and then they get credits, the same number of credits as their box is worth. And those credits can be spent in an online store. And then they would get, so whatever they order in the online store on the week that they return comes in their regular box. So again, this is like a huge additional amount of work for me. I deal with all the special, the online store and making sure those orders are fulfilled. But we just saw like it was such a big issue for people because most people travel in the winter, or sorry, in the summer, they go away and they don't want to waste their money. Whereas in the past, I think the attitude was like, oh, well, we're supporting this farmer. We bought a share. We'll have our neighbor pick it up, or, you know, we'll donate it, or, you know, there was sort of a sense of like, you know, investing in like larger, this larger local or sustainable ag movement. And now it's like really about the customer and getting your money's worth and making sure it's convenient and all those things. And it's not, I mean, I'm not complaining about it. I think it's great that local food is more available, overall. But it is interesting just to see like all the ways we sort of bend over backwards to make things work for our members.
I see it almost as an alternative means of shopping now.
Mm-hmm.
And getting fresher food. I mean, even at a farm stand, it's usually, you know, the leftovers or whatever.
Right.
So I think it's, there's a lot of value to that. I think I'll end at the end of the tape maybe with, you know, your greatest success stories.
Yeah.
From that, right now what I'd like to ask you about is if you could be a little bit more specific about how people have cooperated.
Okay. So how people have cooperated. Let's see.
You mentioned planning, equipment.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there's...
What about schooling? Or shopping?
Yeah, so definitely bulk purchasing. So every year, one of the growers in our co-op organizes a purchase of fertilizer from Portland. So it's a specific fertilizer that's certified organic because it can be hard to find products that are certified organic. And so they now bring down a few pallets of this fertilizer, they deliver it. So it makes the cost of distribution so much less because we're buying it together. There are a lot of cases where people are sharing equipment. One of our producers got a potato hiller and he lends that out to other people. Two of our growers actually ended up starting a garlic business, a garlic seed business together. So that was kind of a spinoff. And there was, we actually did get some funding, and this is a little bit different because this is really about seed production. But I would say out of the 7 growers in our co-op, I think 6 of them also produce as a separate enterprise organic seed that they sell on contract to seed companies. So in the probably 2007, we got some funding, and it was through the co-op to purchase some seed cleaning equipment. So now between the co-op members, there are 4 pieces of seed cleaning equipment that can be used by other members of the co-op. Yeah.
Has there been any cooperation about schooling or childcare? Or?
I mean, if anything informally, I can't say with us that we've necessarily benefited from any schooling. Yeah, but no, I wouldn't say it's an issue. I'm trying to think.
Grants writing.
Sorry?
Grants writing.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Grant writing. Trying to think. I just thought of another. What was it? Yeah, I mean marketing for sure, because we're all marketing, and we created banners for some of the farmers that attend markets regularly. So they actually have a Siskiyou banner that we have them put up at their market. So they're marketing obviously their own farm, but then they're also marketing the co-op as a whole.
How has your work with the extension program benefited the co-op and vice versa?
Well, I think in terms of how the co-op benefits my work at OSU Extension, I kind of have this mini focus group that happens every Thursday morning. So I go to PACOUT and I kind of hear like what is this handful of growers talking about? What issues are they dealing with? What's on their mind? What are they concerned about? And I think being an extension, I mean, extension is part of the university, and the danger is always that we're kind of in our ivory tower and we, you know, are reading national reports and we're hearing about all the research that's coming out of the university systems, but we're not necessarily kind of keeping our finger on the pulse of what's happening locally. And so that's great for me because I have this kind of instant in where I can kind of find out, like I said, what people are thinking about, what are educational programs that would be useful to them and practical. So that's been great. A lot of our classes that we offer through Small Farms are on farm. We find that people learn the most, they're the most engaged, not when they're sitting in a classroom looking at a PowerPoint. I know it's not surprising, but when they're actually in the field, walking around with the farmer, seeing with their very own eyes whatever practice or whatever enterprise or whatever crops being grown. And so it's been helpful for me to have these really tight connections with these growers because they're willing to host events for me, and you know, they're willing to come in and teach about different topics. And I make sure that we can pay them from the OSU budget, so it's not as if I'm asking for this favor, but it is nice to have those kind of solid relationships.
Talk about your role as Small Farms. I see the Small Farms as a means of getting new growers into mm-hmm. the system.
Yeah.
And people who are hobbyists, essentially, but
yeah.
kind of a level above the master gardeners.
Right. Yeah, so I mean, I think one of the ways that extension is great is it really it provides some structure for getting to know the farming community. So, for example, we offer a course called Growing Farms, and it's depending on which way we run it, it's usually 4 or 6 meetings, and it's kind of a business planning class. It's sort of looking at what are the markets, what is your soil and water like, what enterprises should you choose based on those things. You know, what is your lifestyle? How do you want to spend your life? How much time and energy do you have to focus on your farm? How much money do you need to make off your farm? Just kind of looking at large scale, whole planning, whole system planning. And so I always bring a lot of farmers into that class. And it's often people that are just have moved to the area. They're just kind of, you know, entering the agricultural community. And the feedback I often get is that, you know, just getting to see the landscape of farmers. So getting to meet people like Don Tipping and David Mostew and the Fries, having exposure to who are the big players in the community and how can they fit in with, say, a new niche crop or a new marketing scheme or, you know, just kind of getting the lay of the land. So I think that's really important. Our League of Women Farmers has been really successful. We've been running that since 2008, and we meet either monthly or bi-monthly on different farms. We have discussion groups. We occasionally, we have a lot of skill building sessions. So upcoming, we have a chainsaw class for women farmers. We're building a cob oven. We've done carpentry and welding and pruning and just a lot of the more hands-on skills that women have historically been more marginalized from and may not feel comfortable for whatever gender reasons, learning in a co-ed setting. So that's a big emphasis on what we do. But there is, again, there's like through this network of women farmers that's well established, that meets regularly, there's again a lot of that social capital built up. So we see time and again people coming together to support each other. We've had, it's funny now, a lot of the meetings we have are baby showers. You know, we get together when someone's getting married to make flower bouquets for them. We had one woman, longtime member, whose husband died a couple years ago, and we organized an event to help her weed her new beetle bank. It was a hedgerow she'd put in to attract beneficials. She was completely overwhelmed with her orchard and her other, you know, and economic enterprises, and so she had just kind of let this hedgerow. She hadn't done any work on it and it was really weedy. So we just got out for a couple hours and, you know, it was probably 10 or 15 of us, but we were just able to get so much done in that time. So it's that kind of thing, you know, that sort of like just convening people. Historically, you know, the extension has been all about extending. I mean, that's where the name came from. It's extending the university research and knowledge out into the communities. And more, we're really just acknowledging that there's so much knowledge within these communities, and it's really about getting people together to share, not to take away from the importance of bringing in their research and bringing in the experts who've spent, you know, the last 20 years studying symphylins or studying, you know, mosaic virus or whatever it is. That's great and important. There's a place for it, but it's really about bringing farmers together to share the applied knowledge they have.
You're so You're so my hero.
Oh, God, I'm not. I'm a total fraud.
You are my hero.
No, you're so sweet. I'm not.
Oh my gosh. So you've been farming since 98, and you're really embedded. You know a lot of people. You have access to a lot of different groups. You convene many different groups. How have you seen the practice of agriculture and the markets for agriculture change over the last 10 years, 12, well, more than that now?
Yeah, well, I mean, I would say the biggest trend that we're noticing in the Rogue Valley is a saturation in direct markets, especially for vegetable production in particular. So a lot of
what that means.
So what that means is that where before you could, you know, say 10 years ago, you could move to this valley, start growing 6 acres of mixed vegetables, go to markets and do really well at a grower's market and sell most of your product and feel really good about what you come home with. Now it's much harder. There are a lot of people growing the same kinds of things, selling to the same markets. And it's just, I mean, to me, it's like an issue of population. So we don't have a huge metropolitan area that we're selling into. And, so we kind of like, if you talk about the choir, the people that want to buy, you know, that their value is to buy from a local farmer and they're going to go out of their way. They're going to take their lunch break to go to the market on Thursday or on Tuesday. We've kind of saturated those people, and so now it's like, how do we break into the people that go to Fred Meyer's and shop there, or, you know, go to Albertson's, or, you know, how do we actually sell to them? And so, you know, selling into wholesale markets is problematic, and I don't know how much you want me to go into that, but, you know, there's issues around pricing is probably the biggest one. You know, there's a little bit of a margin. Some of the stores will pay a little bit more to be able to market that this is local, but it's not that much more. So if you're a really small farm, if you're growing 3 to 5 acres of vegetables, you just can't get the prices that would make it profitable. So do you scale up? Do you dig deeper into the local markets? How, you know, do you try to grow niche products that you can sell locally? It's pretty tricky. And then there's other issues with selling to wholesale, things like, you know, you might need certifications that could be cumbersome for small farms. You're going to need to offer a really consistent product, because those grocery store owners, they are also operating on really narrow margins, also operating on really not a lot of time. So for them to make one call to a West Coast distributor and not have to think again about, are they going to get their heirloom tomatoes or whatever it is they want. There's some issues. We are OSU Small Farms, and Thrive especially has been working a lot on making it easier for people to grow wholesale. So that's one big issue, trend that we've seen. Another one is just the cost of inputs keep going up, and they go up at a higher rate than the cost of produce. So I think a lot of farmers don't really know their cost of production. And they're afraid to charge more. And so they're probably not making enough money. Statewide, the OSU Small Farms Program has a cost study cohort. And we have a group of farmers in Southern Oregon that are tracking their cost of production. And that's primarily labor is what you're tracking. So how much does it take to plant and weed and harvest this row of cabbage, and then, you know, what do you need to actually charge for that cabbage in order to be profitable? And so we're looking at that and trying. It's really hard to get farmers to keep records. So the cost study program we've tried to simplify it as much as possible so people aren't having to do a ton more of record keeping. But it's still challenging. And some farmers, frankly, don't really want to look at their numbers because they'd rather not know that they're making $9 an hour. It's tricky, but I think that if we're really, I mean, sustainable farming is not just environmentally or socially sustainable, it's economically sustainable. So how do we make sure farms are making enough money to support themselves, to get their kids in college, you know, to pay for healthcare, to have some savings for when they want to retire. And so that's just another That's a huge issue.
Yeah, I might as well. $1
a pound.
Yeah. I'll get a couple. Yeah. I'll get a couple.
Well, I bought 1,000 because I figured people would vote.
Okay.
Right?
Okay, yeah.
And I want to have them on hand because I'm sick of, like, waiting to get organic. I'm waiting to get I get tired of, like, forgetting to get organic cover.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I keep getting it on my cert every time. I keep getting nailed for non-compliance.
Yeah.
See, so I'm like, I'm just going to put 500 pounds in
the
fridge and keep it for a few years, you know?
Yeah, no, I'll take five.
They're Magnus.
They're nice.
Yeah, they were good.
Yeah, I was happy with them.
Gosh, well, I mean, I guess I think of heritage as what you leave behind. So what are you leaving to your future generations within your family as well as to your community as a whole? And then looking backwards, it's kind of what you've come from and what you've inherited. I guess heritage and inherited must be related. So I guess I think of it as looking at time through kind of, you know, a cross section of time. So looking at what, you know, what is passed down through the generations and yeah, I guess a word I feel like is, I feel like legacy is like sort of somewhat of a similar idea is like, you know, what do you inherit? What do you, what do you get from your own ancestry as well as the physical place where you live, and then conversely, what are you leaving to those? Stewardship, yeah, that's a tricky one. I mean, stewardship to me can be defined, it's not an inherently good word. I think I have some negative connotations with that word as well. I mean, I think in the best scenario, stewardship is when I think of it in terms of like how permaculture, like the ideals of permaculture, like you really look at a landscape and you don't rush, which is, you know, our cultural tendency is to move really quickly, but you observe, you take a lot of time. I think the precautionary principle that's used in Europe is so helpful, just, you know, really taking a lot of time before taking action. And then according to what the highest needs of the land and the community, taking care of the land in accordance with that, or taking care of people or any kind of institution or really any body of sorts. But I think the idea of stewardship, there's sort of this implicit like hierarchy or relationship that's created where one entity is like supposed to be in charge of the other and taking care of it. And so I think that like that has to be really looked at and examined as like, oh, what is that power dynamic? If I'm stewarding you, whatever you is, does that, you know, what kind of authority do I have over you? And what does that mean that you need me to take care of you? So I don't know. I think it's problematic, but in the highest, I mean, done well and in the highest, done for the highest good and with that most integrity, then I think it's really about care, observation, and right relationship. Yeah, I mean, I've studied sustainability and I know, you know, you look at those, the three aspects of sustainability, environmental, social, economic, and more I really buy into the need for all three. I think when I came into farming, it was all about environmental stewardship. It was all about, you know, increasing soil fertility and not using any herbicides and water conservation. It was really all like that was sort of the whole emphasis. And more I've seen, well, what I really believe is that it's really about the economic and the environmental, and then the social just comes naturally out of that. It's just sort of like it's born out of the other two. I don't know. I just made that up, so I don't know if that's true or not. But but I do see it more and more as like, oh yeah, I mean, it's one thing to have all these great environmental practices, but if you can't meet your family's needs financially, you're not going to be around in a couple of years. And more, that's really what I emphasize in the Small Farms program is how can we make this economically viable for you? Because I think a lot of people that come into farming, a lot of the demographic I work with, they have those values of environmental and social care. And it's that economic piece that people are like shy away from. And it's actually like, that's the key, because that's what's gonna make it so we're all here in 10 years. And how I see our farm continuing into the future or not continuing into the future. You know, I think that it's really about looking at the individuals involved and what we need to be happy and fulfilled and satisfied. And so what I see, I mean, for us, you know, at this point, we're still paying a pretty large mortgage and we still have kids that are dependent. And so we have the need to generate a good amount of income. But as that is going to taper off in the next 5 years or so, we've talked a lot about not doing the Siskiyou co-op, not being in that coordination role, and really having Tom be able to work on the seed production the most, which is really his passion, and it's the enterprise that's really best suited to our land, and it takes advantage of his skill set in terms of seed breeding and seed selection and just doing a really good job of stewarding those seed varieties. And I think that is like what would make him happy. And then for me, I really enjoy my work with OSU, so I could see doing more of that as our kids get older and being able to kind of supplement. So anyway, I guess that's kind of a short-term answer, is just focusing more on what we love to do, and less having to focus less on making as much money as possible. And then in terms of like long-term succession planning, it's hard to know. I mean, we've purposefully over the years put a lot of perennials in, so we have a lot of fruit trees and nut trees. And of course our hope is that one of our kids would want to take over. They both love the farm. They love, you know, what we've created, but I also realistically, you know, I don't expect them to farm. I don't know. To be honest, we haven't thought a ton about it. So I don't know, actually, what to say. I feel like we're a little far. We're not quite there yet in terms of getting real about the succession planning. I think I think we have quite a few years left in us of being here, possibly. I mean, I think, honestly, like the most exhausting thing that we do is the CSA. And it is really satisfying on some levels. It's satisfying to like coordinate this awesome co-op. It's satisfying to like deliver food to all these people. But it's a lot of work. It's a lot of busy work. It's a lot of our time. And it's a lot of travel. You know, Tom has to, he spends an entire day doing deliveries. And so being able to cut that out would feel like a real luxury and really focus on seed production. It's funny you ask about succession, because in some ways the question that's more on my mind right now is the succession of the co-op. Because it is, like I said earlier, you know, the co-op is great and it's a structure, but it's also a product of all of our personalities and how we work together. And part of that is that Tom and I have held it together all these years and looked for opportunities, and you know, we've held the container of the co-op. And as we think about, I mean, even if it's 5 years off, I mean, we still need to think about like, okay, so what's gonna happen next? At this point, none of the other growers in the co-op want to be in our position. So it's unclear. And I've actually thought about writing a grant to do a feasibility study and to look into like, what are our options? And there's someone I have in mind who's really smart about food hubs and business structures, who I'd actually get to do the research and to think about what are the next steps? Could we go into more wholesale marketing? Could we add a lot more growers? Could we be selling to institutions or selling to chefs? I mean, there's so many options because we have this great structure, but it's going to change. It's going to change how the co-op looks. It's going to change how it feels. It's not going to be this cozy entity anymore. And we're all going to have to let that go and let something else be born, which is painful. It's hard to let go of something that is really sweet and feels good and works, but is not going to work forever. So what is that new, how can we enter that new phase as gracefully as possible with, you know, with as much foresight and consciousness as we can? So that's the succession piece, actually, that's on my mind a lot more than the farm. Hopefully my kids will want a farm, but I don't know, I'm not counting on anything. So. In terms of the future of agriculture in the valley, I mean, it's hard to talk about the future without talking about cannabis. I mean, that's part of the present as well. There was just an article in the Mail Tribune about how cannabis will probably be like pears and wine grapes in this valley, that it's, you know, it's going to be huge. It will attract tourists. It's going to be a huge player in the economy. And with OSU Extension, I'm actually not allowed to address that issue at all because we receive federal funds. So I can't have classes on cannabis production. I can't really consult. I can't consult with cannabis producers. So it's a little bit of a realm that I'm not that comfortable in discussing. I don't really understand a lot of the issues at play. I'm certainly aware that, you know, there's talk of a land grab. So a lot of land being bought up, often by people from out of state who want to produce cannabis. I think, you know, it's an area of Oregon that's really good for cannabis production in terms of heat units and aspects and soils. So it's definitely, you know, we see a lot of it being grown here. There's concern about this land grab and for rec grows, you know, they need to have a good water right. So there's a concern of is a lot of the land with good water rights going to be taken up in cannabis production and not, you know, food production. So there's a few things, the way I think of it. There is the question of the future. I think none of us know what's going to happen with cannabis. I mean, it could be another boom and bust situation where it's, you know, the green rush and everyone's going to buy land and grow plants, and then in a few years it's so hard to know what the market's going to do. And, you know, if it becomes federally legal and it can be grown anywhere, there wouldn't really be the same export market. You know, I think Oregon's already growing way more cannabis than we use in the state. So there's that issue, is kind of like, well, it's so hard to predict. We're kind of in this influx. Regulations are in flux. Markets are in major flux. So that's hard to predict. And I don't have any idea. I don't feel like I can speculate. And then the other issue that's interesting is that, you know, it's bringing a lot of money to our counties. So in some ways, like, our CSA grew quite a bit this year, and it's hard to know exactly why, but sometimes I wonder, well, there, you know, there may be more money in the pockets of people that want to buy local food, that maybe have some of those agricultural values, or there's just more money around, so people are buying more CSA boxes. I don't know for sure, but I do wonder, like, you know, it's a new tax base, and it's potentially bringing wealth to the county that could really be good for local foods, because obviously there is a price margin on organics and locals. There needs to be, and so if we have more people that can afford that, and maybe more people that share those values, not necessarily, that could be a good thing for the local food movement. So it's hard to say. I mean, I think there's certainly unintended consequences. The land grab is a concern. Labor is another huge concern. I talked to a lot of farmers that can't find people to work on their farms because they're able to make so much more on cannabis operations. There's some seasonality with that too. October is a notorious time to get help on your farm. So I've heard some really difficult stories about farmers that have lost crops because they weren't able to hire people to come in and weed them. So that's another, you know, that's an unintended consequence. So it's hard to say. I mean, I think in general, it's just, there's so many unknowns. But I do think that is obviously having a big effect. Yeah, I mean, I think, just in terms of wrapping up, I think that, I mean, I'm most struck by where we live and how we live when I travel, of course. And I guess, you know, whenever I leave the Rogue Valley, I'm just aware of how much my life is around, like, eating well. And I don't know, I'm not really sure how to wrap this up, but I just, like, I kind of take for granted how much, like, living close to the land and having, like, a really intimate relationship with my food it's so intrinsic to how we live that I forget until I go away and don't have that experience. So from growing our own food and having, you know, like, living near the food that I'm eating, I mean, that's wonderful. But then also, like, knowing growers that are producing my meat and producing my eggs and producing my cheese. So having those relationships with people that are providing the food that I don't grow, and then just the way we eat, you know, it's like, it's all based on what's in season and what's available. And not that we don't go to the grocery store and buy other stuff as well, but yeah, I mean, to know that, you know, my rancher lives down the road, the person who bakes our bread lives down another road. I mean, it's just, yeah, I think we're really lucky. And I think having so much access to so many great producers of different types of food is just, it's such a blessing and easy to take for granted when you live here for a long time. But, yeah, like I said, just really intrinsic to the quality of life